May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Okay, so if you came to church today looking for a glimpse of the kingdom of God, don't go snooping around the gospel. You're not going to find it there today. It is such a troubled reading that we have just gone through in the Gospel of Mark. It really seems difficult to kind of celebrate that reading at the end, and Elizabeth's kind of the gospel of the Lord, I think, was a little tepid, don't you think, in terms of... There doesn't seem to be a lot of gospel going on here in this particular reading. We have an adulterous marriage. We have a stepdaughter dancing for her stepfather and her guests, and a stepfather who enjoyed the dance a lot, way too much. And the mother of this daughter watching her daughter dance for her stepfather and realizing that moment where the stepfather is liking the dance too much and saying to herself, no, she doesn't say to herself, whoa, this is wrong, I gotta put a stop to this. She says, this is a great opportunity to be exploited. It is a difficult reading. To compound that, it's kind of difficult if you know the characters to figure out who's who. So I'm going to kind of walk you through it just for a second. First of all, at the time of Jesus, in kind of that couple of decades right around there, there were quite a few Herods in the history of Israel in that time period. The Herod who ruled at the time of Jesus' birth was called Herod the Great. And Herod the Great, we know for a number of things, he went through a huge building project. He built up the Temple Mount and the temple that we know of, that Jesus spent so much time there. He's also the guy who in the New Testament is said to have killed children in an effort to get rid of this Messiah who was born in Bethlehem. We don't really know if that's historically accurate. What we do know is it fits his temperament and his personality. He was amazing in terms of some of the accomplishments he made during his reign, but he was also unbelievably ruthless. Herod the Great makes Henry the Eighth look like kind of the ultimate Norman Rockwell family man. He had 5 children, 5 wives, 10 children. He executed not only wives, but he executed children as well, just because not they did something, but he just grew suspicious of them. So let's stay focused on this particular story on 2 of his sons that were lucky enough to not draw his attention and to live into adulthood. To complicate this telling of this story, Herod the Great, 2 sons that we are going to be talking about in this particular story are named Herod. So we have Herod Philip, and the other is Herod Antipas. Herod Philip was married to a woman whose name was, wait for it, Herodias, because that's the only name we seem to be able to get in this particular story. So Herod Philip married to Herodias, and they have a daughter who fortunately they did not name Herod. And they named Salome, who is the daughter who dances in the story today. Now, the other Herod, Herod Antipas, who's half-brother of Herod Philip, Herod Antipas meets Herodias, decides she's some special, I have got to have her with me, and so steals his half-brother's wife and convinces her to come live with him, and they get married. And that's why John says, I'm not okay with all of that. That seems a little strange to me. What's equally strange is that somehow Herodias decides to bring her daughter Salome into this new situation. So just in case all of that wasn't clear to you, Herod Philip and Herodias have a daughter named Salome. Herodias leaves Herod Philip to be married to her brother-in-law, Herod Antipas, and she takes her daughter with her. Herodias brought this daughter into the new home, Salome. She's the dancer. So let me be clear. There are no good guys in this story. Each of these people may have been wonderful in their own right in some aspect of their life, but it is not shining through in the story right here at this particular moment. Before he died, Anthony Bourdain was interviewed about how many famous celebrity chefs seem to be guilty of abusing the power that they wield in the kitchen and in their relationships with their employees. Bourdain said that he doesn't believe that power corrupts. Instead, he thinks the answer to this situation that we see is that there are just creepy people in the world, and when you give creepy people power, they wield that power in creepy and abusive ways. Unfortunately, research does not side with him. There has been a lot of research on this subject over the years, and matter of fact, there have been a number of studies, research done across socioeconomic boundaries, done across gender, done across race, across nationalities, and every single one of these studies shows the same thing, that in general, people who are given lots of power begin to be corrupted by that power and act differently, less morally. As John Acton said, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. He was actually writing to a leader in the church at that particular time when John Acton said that. And research has shown that he is surprisingly and disappointingly accurate. I was listening to a show on NPR the other day, a radio show, and I tuned in, and they were interviewing a woman who I never caught her name, so you're never going to hear her name from me because I didn't ever get to hear it on the radio show. But the guest described the world in terms of being like a room in which a mouse and an elephant live. Said, in this room in which the mouse and the elephant live, the mouse knows everything there is to know about the elephant. The mouse knows when the elephant wakes and when the elephant sleeps. The mouse knows when the elephant eats and when it goes to the bathroom. The mouse knows everything about the elephant because its very survival depends on knowing who the elephant is and what its habits are. The flip side of that is the elephant may or may not know that there is a mouse in the room. And even if the elephant does know there's a mouse in the room, it spends very little time, if any, being worried, concerned, aware of what the mouse's habits or desires are, because those don't impinge on the elephant's life in any way. Herod the Great, Herod Antipas, Herod Philip, Herodias were all elephants. It's easy to hear about them and their story and marvel at how power has corrupted them and see this as kind of a story that we project as being typical of only other people. But the woman on NPR who was talking about this elephant-mouse analogy went further. She took it further and she said, the danger is that each of us only sees ourselves as a mouse. You see, we're all keenly aware of those times that we are the mouse. But her point was, we don't just live in one room, we live in many rooms. And we're not always aware of the mouse. Sometimes we're not the mouse, sometimes we are the elephant. And in those rooms, we remain keenly unaware of who's the mouse in our life and how our life choices affect them. I think the only way we can overcome the Lord Acton effect and his prediction is to seek to be aware of others in our world and in our environment. One of the goals for us is to become aware of where you are the mouse, but even more importantly, to become aware of where you are the elephant. Look, I can tell you the times and places where I am or where I have been the mouse in the room. I think most of us can. That's pretty easy to do, right? Those are the times we're keenly aware of, but if we are asked to create a list of the times and the places where each of us are the elephant, that becomes a much more difficult list to create. The Gospel of Matthew praises what we do for the least of these. And we use that phrase a lot in Christendom, the least of these. The problem for me with that particular phrasing in that passage is that if you have people who are least, then you have people who are greater. And the moment we begin to describe a situation in such a way that we talk about the least and the implied greater, then we are perpetuating what we know already is an unhealthy imbalance. The Bible uses another word that I also think, that I think is more helpful. And the word is stranger. I like this word because I think we all, every one of us, has not only sometimes but many times in our lives known what it means to be a stranger. I'm not sure that many of us, if you said, "Are you part of the least of these?" we would be able to say, "Yeah, that's me," or I don't know. But we all know what it means to be a stranger, to sometimes be the outsider in a group. Regardless who you are and where you've come from, you have been a stranger. Regardless of the fact if you have never even left your own hometown in your entire life, you have been a stranger. And maybe, therefore, it's easier for us to use that kind of terminology and to begin to look for and serve the stranger in our midst, because that's an experience that we can all identify with in our own lives. Imagine in any group of people that forms in any way, there are always people who feel like they are strangers, and there are probably always people who are being treated as strangers. No wonder the Bible spends an enormous amount of time talking about how we treat strangers. Because you don't even have to go away from home to be a stranger. Nor does somebody have to be from some foreign exotic land for them to be a stranger in your midst. There is a remarkable and disturbing tendency amongst humanity to create strangers. Wherever we can identify a difference between us, we tend to create dividing lines. We see strangers and we use faith or gender or race or language or orientation or politics or a host of other things we use in order to divide lines between us and create strangers. So how do we change? Who's our model? Well, not surprisingly, from the pulpit, you're going to hear a suggestion that Jesus just might be our model in this particular case. Jesus had a remarkable ability to recognize the stranger and then to see them, welcome them, listen to them, and love them. Jesus recognized the child as the stranger, the woman at the well, the centurion, the Samaritan, the tax collector, the person possessed by a demon. They were all strangers in their own way, and Jesus was keenly aware of them, recognized them, and treated them, each one of them, with respect and love, offering them the good news of God's love in their lives. I began this sermon by saying, if you're looking for a glimpse of the kingdom of God, it will not be found in the story of our gospel today. The entire gospel seems to be a story of people who are strangers to one another and treating one another as strangers. There will always be strangers. But imagine a world in which all the children of God seek to spend their time looking for the stranger, identifying the stranger, loving the stranger, welcoming the stranger, welcoming them with the love that we know that Jesus Christ has offered to us. We turn and offer it to them without restriction. If we lived in that way, if we but strive to live in that way, we would surely begin to see a glimpse of the kingdom of God. And we would be most certainly the people, the one united people who God is calling us to be. Amen.